Good morning, early birds. This is a stock reminder that our pre-show is provided courtesy of Val, a member here at Emmanuel. If you are not catching it live, however, you can feel free to skip ahead to the 15-minute mark if you like, as the service itself will begin in about 15 minutes. Welcome to another e-service for Emmanuel Evangelical Lutheran Church of Paynes Point in rural Oregon, Illinois. These videos are designed to serve as a stand-in for our regular Sunday morning worship for those unable to attend in person for any reason. Therefore, this is designed to be participatory. Feel free to pray, confess, and sing along with us. An announcement or two may be included, but please mind your emails and the newsletter to know what's happening in the congregation. Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. Thanks for connecting in this way. Just a few announcements that are particular to this Sunday. This coming Sunday is All Saints, so if you've got a name you'd like read aloud, please get that to me as soon as possible. Second thing, the ministry I could not quite remember the name of last week is Holiday Hope Chest. That's the one LSSI puts on when we participate in it. It usually involves a tree, so I was kind of stuck on the tree. If you haven't yet and you'd like to participate in that, they're only taking gift cards, and because of the state of things, if you'd like to simply contribute money, then you can do that. Write a check, send it to the financial secretary or to the church. He and Rich and Sean will take care of the rest. So thank you to them for doing that, to LSSI for facilitating, and to all of you for participating. Hopefully we brighten the Christmas season for a family in need. And those are families right here in Illinois with needs. Third thing, I keep thinking when I look into the viewfinder here, I actually had to come back over to re-record this and something else, so it may be even worse than the rest of the video, but I think those bags under my eyes get darker and bigger a little bit every week, pretty consistently, for about 7 months. Wonder what that's about. Our region is in increased mitigation. What this means for us, a few weeks ago, our gathering size limit was 50. We just kept distance, wore masks. We were outside when possible, and that was pretty easy to manage. Number came down to 25, so we took a step back, assessed how to handle that. We decided to use a registration system. Our protocol now is if the gathering size is between 11 and 49, that's exactly what we'll do. And then at 10 or less, we suspend in-person worship. There's a little bit of a caveat to this, which is if we get word that guidelines are changing on the weekend, we don't necessarily cancel that coming Sunday. If it's workable, maybe close registration. I've had a number of people offer. They say if this situation arises, simply let them know. They'll refrain to get the number down. So we've done that for today, if you're catching this live. But going forward, until things improve, we'll be all online for the time being. And I won't belabor it. You know how I feel about this. I've written plenty and said plenty on here. I'm just going to point out, because I feel like it's not being spelled out explicitly well enough at the moment, but this trend, hospital caseload going up, I think I have to actually reverse it. I don't know, with the mirror thing, but with the positivity rate going up and this growth, the fact that it's headed in the wrong direction and didn't slow down, hasn't slowed down. These things have happened several places in our country. Early instances where the virus was very bad, of course, not knowing what they were dealing with, maybe handling some things incorrectly. That's different. We've had now months, 4 or 5 months of these trends happen in a place, they implement mitigations, and the trend comes the other way. And basically, what it comes down to, this is well observed at this point, the main factor for whether that keeps going up, whether it hangs there for a long time, or whether it comes right back down, is whether people follow the guidelines or not. And that's what we're looking at right now. If you want church to be open, you want restaurants to serve people, you want small businesses to survive this, the trick is to follow the guidelines, because the quicker we get this thing turned around, it's hard to imagine like everybody getting on board, right? There's nothing that we could get everybody on board for, but you could imagine that. And in that imaginary situation, everyone getting on board means that number, it just about resets the clock in about 2 weeks. We could be right back to good looking numbers, back to 50 people in gatherings really, really quickly, if everybody got on board. And the reality is right now, the more people throw parties, you know, ignore distancing, don't wear masks, don't wash their hands, whether that's at work or at home with people over or what have you, school, the longer this is going to be. And we want this to be as short as possible. And if you're anything like me, you know, that's the only way we're going to get rid of those bags under our eyes. So, you know what to do. We've heard it 1,000 times. Be safe, be responsible, and for this morning, let's get started. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God in whose image we are made, who claims and calls us beloved. Amen. Holy One, we confess that we are not awake for you. We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the least of our siblings. We do not see your beautiful image in one another. We are infected by sin that divides your beloved community. Open our hearts to your coming. Open our eyes to see you in our neighbor. Open our hands to serve your creation. Amen. Beloved, we are God's children, and Jesus, our beloved, opens the door to us. Through Jesus, you are forgiven. By Jesus, you are welcomed in. And in Jesus, you are called to rejoice. Let us live in the promises prepared for us from the foundation of the world. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty God, gracious Lord, we thank you that your Holy Spirit renews the church in every age. Pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep them steadfast in your word. Protect and comfort them in times of trial. Defend them against all enemies of the gospel. And bestow on the church your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading comes from the 46th Psalm. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be moved. God will help it when the morning dawns. The nations are in an uproar. The kingdoms totter. He utters his voice. The earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord. See what desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations. I am exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Here ends the reading.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above. Before our Father's throne, we pour our ardent prayers, our fears, our hopes, our aims are one, our comforts and our cares. We share each other's woes, our mutual burdens bear, and often for each other flows the sympathizing tear. When we ascend depart. It gives us inward pain, but we shall still be joined in heart and hope to meet again. From sorrow, toil, and pain, and sin, we shall be free, and perfect love and friendship reign through all eternity.
Our gospel reading this morning comes from the Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 8th chapter. Then Jesus said to some of the locals who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The son has a place there forever. So if the son makes you free, you will be free indeed." This is the gospel of our Lord. Grace and peace to you, sisters and brothers in Christ. Reformation Sunday, the commemoration, the remembrance of the Reformation of the 16th century. Now, each year, we Lutherans, who are our tradition is born of the Reformation, we take a detour on this last Sunday in October and read this set of texts. And each year, we, at least me with my preaching and a lot of other places, will look at the Reformation and see how some idea, some principle, might have been found in that story and then apply it to today. So let's start by going back in time. We'll start way back, but then we'll get up to Luther's day. Now, speaking of way, this is to way oversimplify things, like 1,000 years summed up in about a minute. But when the Roman Empire fell, the Roman Catholic Church was still there, and in Europe, it was about the only place that still had things like record keeping, schools, refuge for orphans, and so on, things that we might consider functions of the government. In other words, there was all of a sudden this civil and administrative vacuum. Nobody was doing those jobs, but the church could do them, so the church ended up filling that vacuum. They had the power, therefore they had the responsibility. There was a need to stabilize society in their area, and this they had the institution, the resources, to do that for the betterment of humanity, so they were called to do exactly that. Sounds good, right? Unfortunately, as human things go, and power corrupting like it does, eventually we reach a point in which the church seems more concerned with political power and financial gain than with helping people. At the same time, civil authorities are reemerging, regaining their footing, and the ability to do their jobs. That's not a winning combination. We've got a church, power hungry, money hungry. You know, they didn't want to let that power go. And every year, they're less and less justified in having that power and that money as the civil governments could do their jobs. Again, this is a big oversimplification, but I'm bringing it up to point out this. Contexts changed. Times changed. What was good and noble in one age became abusive in another. So by Luther's day, he saw this thing like, for example, indulgences, basically a tax on forgiveness, encouraging people that if they pay more money, they can have their relatives sent, dead relatives sent to heaven faster. Now Luther saw that that was abusive, but after reading the Bible and coming to know God through the scriptures, he realized it was downright contrary to the Gospels. Now it's okay that we have a variety of opinions, traditions, denominations, different ways of interpreting the text. There's actually a lot of good that comes of that. But this one, this was so contrary to Jesus' word. It was like ripping the foundation out from under a building for some temporary gain. But just wait and see how long it takes for everything to fall. But not every idea is foundational. This is the principle from the Reformation that we need to remember today. Some principles are foundational, some are not. Each idea in Christianity and in the political worlds that it touches can be divided into those two categories, but let's frame those two categories another way. On the one hand, we have adiaphora, This is an old term from Greek philosophy that meant an action was neither good nor bad, not moral nor immoral, not permissible nor forbidden. And Luther took it and reapplied it to theology. So that for us, it now means whether you do it or not, believe it or not, encourage others or not, whatever it is, whatever this thing is, it has no bearing on your salvation. Just think of the whole list of actions that cannot save you and cannot condemn you. This is why some theologians, church leaders and the like, will sometimes boil an argument down to whether or not it might risk condemnation. And that can sound extreme, especially from the outside looking in, but, you know, because it kind of sounds like we're just obsessed with heaven and hell. That's the only reason we do things, we're maybe afraid of hell, but that's not it at all. Instead, what it is that inside our Christian realm, particularly Protestants, particularly Lutheran, that's one of the first and most important arguments we can make. Decide if it's adiaphora or not. After that, we can decide if it's beneficial, economical, and so on. You know, just because we can do something doesn't mean we should. At the same time, the reverse is true. Just because someone shouldn't do it doesn't mean the church should claim they can't. Those are different categories. Now, those arguments, separating them out where they belong, begin only after we've determined whether it bears on someone's salvation. Sound fuzzy and ambiguous? It probably should. And it's because, again, times change. In some places, the church is compelled by their calling to do things like build and maintain schools. At other times, it's simply not a priority. There are dozens of examples like these, and to put it simply, building schools, it's a very Christ-like thing to do, but it does not have anything to do with salvation. It feels funny to lean on these medieval history examples of how times change and therefore the church's calling and some of how it applies its message should have changed as well. It feels weird because we can look to our own lifetimes, right? Things are moving fast. Just in the 21st century, we had two world wars. We had the advent of modern medicine, vaccines and antibiotics. Technologically, we've had a revolution too. Personal computers, the internet, and smartphones. The way we engage with the world, the way our world handles a crisis, and the way we connect when we cannot gather, some of what we do as church now was impossible even a few years ago. Nearly all of it 100 years ago, and the same goes for our governments and other institutions. Together, humanity is figuring things out as they change at a record pace, and the church is trying to do the same. It's especially pronounced, especially weird to look to the past because as I wrote this and as I'm recording it, I'm in and out of phone calls about how to handle the new mitigations that begin today. Fortunately, our church council agreed to a plan that addresses these possibilities ahead of time, so this isn't last-minute decision-making, but boy, do things keep changing quickly. I won't belabor it again, but let's consider our context briefly. Let's note our social and moral responsibility as citizens, and then especially as Christians, who are called to self-giving love for the sake of others, to cherish truth, to defer to those who know more than we do, to cherish life and do whatever uncomfortable and inconvenient things we can if it means we promote and preserve life. How we go about that is changing as fast as the seasons. It's changing faster than that. Our call as Christians remains the same, but how we exactly live it out changes so quickly right now. We have before us, and in our lifetimes, and in our shared history, example after example where the gospel, the call, the principles, they've all stayed the same, but how we live them out changes. One day it was the best thing you could do to go out and volunteer. Now maybe not. So some things are adiaphora because they change. They change with the times. It's not that this category is unimportant. Some of it, sure, but much of it still is important. And I won't dare get into the others, but this is one of the reasons the church is called to continual reformation, to always being made new, because how we love God and neighbor depends in part on our time and place in which we live. We as individuals, as congregations, as the church universal, adapt to those changes to serve God and neighbor as best we can. Now, instead of getting into those other reasons we reform continually, Let's consider category number two. I mean, it's probably clear at this point what's left, right? Because it's going to be the opposite of adiaphora. Over here, it's the matters that do bear on salvation. It's the things that do not change. They are the universal truths, the principles, the calls, the ideals laid upon the heart of every God-fearing soul, no matter when or where they live. Now, it's been suggested, and there's good reason for this, that a mighty fortress is such a great anthem, encapsulation of the Lutheran Reformation, because its basis, Psalm 46, did such a good job of encapsulating Luther's theology. Luther, God is our refuge, a help during times of trouble. We don't fear even though the earth shakes. The city of God shall not be moved. God's voice is enough to melt the world away, enough to bring desolations, to put every enemy to rest, and yet here we are, with God as our refuge. Yes, some things change, but the reality is some things do not. That's the foundation that under the house that we cannot rip out. We need that consistency to maintain sanity. We need promises we can rely on. What God has in store for us is persistence, a safety, a comfort that defies chaos, context, and change, the kind of things that make us struggle to be safe today. There is coming a day where we can be certain of our calling and certain of our safety. We won't have to figure it out based on the time or place. That's firmly here in the second category, the things that bear on our salvation, because God's reliability, consistency, and God's commitment to covenantal relationship and all the rest of God's promises, that's where we hang our hat when it comes to salvation and when it comes to the next age. But it's really one of those promises that Luther focused in on, and we'll finish with it. It's not unlike where we finished in the past few weeks, and it's an appropriate place for every sermon during a trying time to end. The Reformation principle is that, again, every matter can be divided into one of two camps. On the one hand, that which does not bear on salvation, but we can take seriously, like how what we live out our call as Christians, you know, that changes with the times, whether an action is appropriate or not. And that which does bear on salvation, like the consistency, the reliability of God's word. Well, the Reformation kicked off because the church had again removed a crucial portion of its foundation, one of those promises laid out in God's word. And that's that your salvation, it doesn't come from you. It doesn't come from your works. It doesn't come from your birthright or your commitment. It doesn't come from your choosing. It doesn't even come from your church. Your salvation is entirely from a grace outside yourself, afforded to you on account of Christ, activated by faith that it turns out, a faith that was also given to you. You are saved. You can know it. You can proclaim it, and you can say it of others too. Sure, maybe not everyone's saved. This isn't universalism. What Luther titled the bondage of the will, what John Wesley spelled out as prevenient grace, that's still in play. Some people will reject God's grace. God's not a tyrant. He doesn't demand eternal relationship. Salvation is free, but it's not forced. But you who have heard the call, lived with God, know God through Christ, who yearn for an eternity with God, who love God and love neighbor, this reality is firmly in the second camp, the things you can always rely on, that you are saved. You are saved no matter how times change. No matter what changes in the world around us, nothing can change this. God is our refuge and strength. God loves you, and you are saved. Amen.
The church is one foundation, He's Jesus Christ our Lord. She is His new creation, by water and the Word. From heaven He came and sought her to be His holy bride. With His own blood He bought her, and for her life He died. elect from every nation, yet one o'er all the earth. The charter of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one birth. One holy name she blesses, or takes one holy food, and to one hope she presses, with every grace endued. Though with a scornful wonder, men see her sore oppressed, by schisms rent asunder, by heresies distressed. Yet saints their watch are keeping, their cry goes up, how long? And soon the night of weeping shall be the morn of song. Mid toil and tribulation and tumult of her war, she waits the consummation of peace forevermore, till with the vision glorious her longing eyes are blessed, and the great church victorious shall be the church at rest. Yet she on earth hath union with God the three in one, and mystic sweet communion with those whose rest is won. O happy ones and holy, Lord, give us grace that we, like them, the meek and lowly, on high may dwell with thee.
With that, let's confess the faith of the church using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. With confidence in God's grace and mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. In your love, you speak to your church. Give courage and the bond of love to all who gather in your name, that this love turn toward our neighbors. Lord, in your mercy. In your love, you create our earth filled with living things of every kind. Sustain the intricate connections among plants, insects, animals, and organisms we don't even know or recognize. Bless the work of scientists who extend neighbor love to our natural world. Lord, in your mercy. In your love, you guide with justice. Inspire leaders for truthful conversations and wise policies, that decisions are made for the good of all. We pray as well for those who may be in harm's way enacting justice. We pray for firefighters, police officers, first responders, soldiers, especially John, Josh, Tyler, Morgan, Jack, Robert, Matt, Nick, and Dane. Lord, in your mercy. In your love, you tenderly care for your children and nurse them to health. Bring relief to all those who need healing, hope, or restoration this day. We pray especially for those affected by the pandemic, by the disease, by its implications, for healthcare workers, especially in our area, stretched so thin right now. We pray as well for those who need healing and wholeness, for Bethel and Taylor. And we pray for those who have suffered loss. We pray as well for those
whose health needs are immediate and ongoing and come from other sources. We pray for Jerry, Joe, Jim, Robin, Linda, Gary, Gail, Lisa, Joni, Chloe, Connie, Larry, Cindy, John, and Melody, Grace, Danny, Doug, Bailey, Connie, and Kendall, Jean, Horst, Barbara, Richard, Serenata, Ann, Larry, Carol, Jean, Mary, Jean, Edie, Leona, Amy, Dean, Andrea, Dennis, Ida, Mabel, Renee's aunt, Charlene, for Lynette with a recent cancer diagnosis, and for the family of John at his passing. We pray your presence for them. Give them peace that surpasses understanding. Lord, in your mercy. In your love, you accompany us in all of life's transitions. We pray for new parents, those grieving a loss, those who are retiring, and those embarking on new ventures. Lord, in your mercy. In your love, we remember those who were dear to us and now rest in you. We give thanks for Martin Luther and all who seek to reform and renew your church. Give us courage to live out your gospel, revealing your love until our days on earth have ended. Lord, in your mercy. Listen as we call on you, O God, and enfold in your loving arms all for whom we pray. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. And as you take a moment to share a sign of peace by text or by chat, let me remind you that when we cannot gather in person, our offerings are almost entirely gathered by mail, mostly mailed directly to the financial secretary. So as we pray over these gifts given, we give thanks for your generosity and we give thanks to God for God's abundance, however the gifts were given, wherever they were received. Let us pray. God of all goodness, generations have turned to you, gathered around your table, and shared your abundant blessings. Number us among them, that as we gather these gifts from your abundance and give thanks for your rich blessings, we may feast upon your very self and care for all that you have made through Jesus Christ, our sovereign and servant. Amen. As we go forth responsibly into our own homes, may the God of all creation, in whose image we are each made, who claims us and calls us beloved, who strengthens us for service, give you reason to rejoice and be glad. The blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you today and always. Amen. Beloved of God, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Okay, so a brief story just for fun. A few months ago, you may recall, if you've caught all these videos, that I had a week where it was just nothing was going right, was running out of time, wasn't feeling the greatest, and I realized I could get everything done on time if I kind of skirted by with jump cuts. And I don't like jump cuts. I don't like the way they look. I don't like the way they sound. I think they're unprofessional. I get that it's like a style for some platforms, but I just don't want to do it unless there's like a really good reason. And I had a pretty good set of reasons about 2 weeks ago. And it again had to do with time and what have you. But to get real narrow to one reason, it's because the software I use, if I can get it on the screen, maybe I will here, as a teleprompter, you can speed it up, slow it down. It'll actually tell you how long it's going to take. It's rather nifty. And as it sometimes goes, a good portion of the sermon, the majority up front, worked well at a faster pace, but the last bit worked better at a slower pace. So what I ended up doing, instead of trying to fumble with changing it or rehearsing it enough to just do that manually, that sort of thing, I ended up just putting a cut in there. What's funny about this is I wanted to see if I could do it on a frame where I was in roughly the same position. So I got to where I was going to make that cut, and I started playing it side by side. I'll put that up here too. And it's remarkable. I mean, it's remarkable. I'm making like the exact same hand gestures. I mean, that's a bit of an exaggeration, but I'm making the same movements and hand gestures and yada, yada, yada. And, you know, this has come up in conversation, not about me, but, you know, watching the debates and things like that, that people, public speakers, tend to have these signature moves. They do the same hand movements over and over, right? This is my over and over hand movement. But what's quirky about it, and I'll just have it like on repeat here, that if you know that the timing is off, that one is faster than the other, that means I'm only about one sentence in before I'm not saying the same thing. It's like a pre-recording list of the motions I'm going to make that don't match with what I'm saying. And I don't know how much I do that, but I'm suspicious now that it might be a lot. So take a look at that. Let me know what you think. And you know what? While we're at it, here's a bit of a supercut of, oh, I don't know. Let's just do like a minute or two of a month's worth of sermons on top of each other. 2 months, something like that. All right, here we go. This is fun post-credit scene stuff. Let's get a little wild. I'm being speculative with this because I have an idea of how I'm going to do this, but I'm not sure I'm going to be able to do it in time. So hopefully you're seeing this on the Sunday I intend. All right, here we go.
Grace and peace to you, sisters and brothers in Christ.
Let's start with a hand gesture we draw your attention.
One that seems to use the car.
It kind of looks like a pyramid, right? You put your eye through it? I'm not going to do that. Some people are quite upset. They think that it has to do with what?
Illuminati?
That could be any lizards, even Satan. It's also a Masonic. It's also on the back of our currency. I mean, it's on the back of our dollar bills, on top of a pyramid. And there it's meant to imply God looking down on the United States with approval. That's quite a few ways to interpret stupid lines, stupid shapes. Shapes are funny that way. Symbols are funny. So, well, let's talk about it. Let's talk about triangles. Or at least triangulation. That's a great thing. When it comes to conflict or disagreement, there's a few ways you can resolve it. Now we've looked at this a fair bit over the past few weeks. This series just about started a few months ago with Jesus advising that if you can't get through to someone who's got problematic behavior in the church, you eventually end up getting someone else to go along with you, and eventually even getting the whole congregation to speak against you. But it didn't start that way. Step one was to go directly to someone. The right way to start problem solving is a straight line. It's from the media. A not so great way is someone else coming toward the person from two different angles. It's not hard to see why that happens. At least if you grew up with siblings,
attended public school,
we've all been there, right? It happens in other places. Someone's feelings get hurt, so you grab someone else and turn it around. If you want things to change in your social circle, you gather up folks, maybe one by one, a little manipulative there, and get the numbers on your side, and then come at the one. God's not looking down upon us with approval. In Jesus' day, despite our characterizations like people that Jesus met, there were several religious and political camps, even more than an entire lifetime with them. There's different philosophical nations, various ethnic and national identities and sizes. So it's a bit misleading to simply refer to them as Jewish.
Some translations even erroneously translate Judean. Maybe the people who lived in that area as Jewish.
Because Jesus was Jewish. Herodians were Jewish. Pharisees were Jewish. And many others not in this. We know Jesus, but let's talk about the others for a moment and what they're up to. Herodians were the Jewish folk who supported
that is true. They fought the way for their families and communities to thrive was to become more like the Romans, or at least more cozy with the Romans. Not at all an uncommon response to imperial occupation. They saw who had the power, they wanted to play nice with those bears.